to be speaking in front of you again this evening, to be able to bring forth a portion of God's Word. Some of you may remember, in the evening lessons, I had been going through Paul's letters to the churches. I'd started in Galatians, had gotten all the way through Ephesians, Philippians, and Colossians, and had taken a break for a while from that, and now we're ready to get started in 1 Thessalonians. So go ahead and turn over there with me, if you will, to 1 Thessalonians, and go ahead and put your bookmark there, because we'll, the first little bit, we'll kind of be going back and forth between this and a portion of the Acts of the Apostles. So hold your bookmark right there for just a little bit. The church at Thessalonica was established in about a three-week period, believe it or not, by the Apostle Paul. If we turn over to Acts, in about chapter 17 is where we will find that. So go ahead and turn there. We will start back a little bit from that, maybe about a chapter or so back from chapter 17. So chapter 17 is where we can find Paul arriving in Thessalonica. But the events that sort of set in motion for him to get there really start in, at the end of chapter 15, as the scriptures begin to talk about Paul's second missionary journey. And so up here on the board, I have for you the path that he took to go along that second missionary journey. He does start down here in Jerusalem, and he goes to the north up through Cilicia, Galatia, goes across the north side of Asia, and you may remember when we did our study through Ephesus and Philippi, the Philippians letter, that the Holy Spirit forbade him to go through all of Asia. So he kind of had to go over the north boundary of Asia there. So that kind of explains that route. If we had an overlay of his first and third missionary journeys, we'd see he's going all through Asia. He's hitting Laodicea, Colossus, all those places. But for his second journey, he does go along the north border of Asia, and he comes to Troas, then crosses the sea into Macedonia area, then down to Achaia, then back over the Aegean Sea to Ephesus, and then a long boat trip to back to Judah. So that's the long and short of the second missionary journey. We can find a few sort of highlights in this to be able to lead us up to it. So in chapter 15, verse 40 says, Paul chose Silas, and he left, being committed to the brethren to the grace of the Lord. So Paul, you may remember, had a disagreement with Barnabas on who should go with him. Barnabas wanted to take Mark. Paul didn't want to take him. And so Paul left Barnabas and Mark to go on their own journey, and Paul selected Silas to go with him. And Paul and Silas left together, and one of the first places that they're recorded coming to is Derbe and Lystra. And it is in this location that Timothy joins Paul and Silas. He is one of Paul's first disciples, you might say, maybe his most successful disciple, based on letters written to him and kind of traditional stories that we have from how far Timothy reached going east. But this is where they encountered Timothy, and from there, Timothy joined Paul and Silas for the rest of the second missionary journey, off and on, which we'll see in just a moment. Staying in chapter 16, verses 9 through 12, it says, a vision appeared to Paul in the night. A man of Macedonia was standing and appealing to him, saying, come over to Macedonia and help us. When he had seen the vision, immediately we sought to go into Macedonia, concluding that God had called us to preach the gospel to them. So putting out to sea from Troas, we ran a straight course to Samothrace, and on the day following to Neapolis, and from there to Philippi, which is a leading city of the district of Macedonia, a Roman colony, and we were staying in this city for some days. So right here is where Paul received that Macedonian vision for someone in Macedonia, the orange area up there, to come over and help them. So they sail from Troas. Remember, this is Paul, Silas, and Timothy at the very least. There may have been others with them that just went unnamed, but at the very least, it's those three gentlemen. They sail over. They hop, skip the island right there, and then come over to Neapolis and then to Philippi. Now, in Philippi, we know one of the better stories in the Acts of the Apostles. So when Paul and Silas were imprisoned, and the account of the Philippian jailer was converted. That's what we have in the latter half of chapter 16. And then in chapter 16, verse 40, it says they went out of the prison and entered the house of Lydia, which is a callback to one of the first people they encountered in Philippi. And when they saw the brethren, they encouraged them and departed. So they departed from Philippi and then came to Thessalonica, right there in the top left corner of your screen. After, we'll read chapter 17 here in a moment, but after Thessalonica, they went to Berea, and this is where they were more noble-minded people because they were searching the scriptures daily. After Berea, you recall, Paul went to Athens, and he had the sermon on Mars Hill, where they had the statue to an unknown god. And after that, he had went to Corinth. So this is kind of the Cliff's Notes version of Paul's second missionary journey. Picked up Timothy, received that vision to cross the Aegean Sea, did such, came to Philippi, touched a couple other places before he came to Thessalonica. And that is where we pick up in Acts chapter 17. So I'm going to zoom in here real quick just so you can see a little better view of the area. You see no less than six towns or cities did Paul go to when he was in Macedonia. It says there in Acts that he went to Neapolis, where it sounds like he just stayed maybe a day, just stopped there probably for supplies. But then he went to Philippi, and it says that they stayed there for some time. So they stayed a long period in Philippi. So now we want to pick up in Acts chapter 17, starting verse 1. It says, when they had traveled through Amphipolis and Apollonia, they came to Thessalonica, where there was a synagogue of the Jews. Okay, so stop right there. We can see then the path that Paul takes from Philippi, traveling west through Amphipolis and then Apollonia, and then going straight through to Thessalonica. Okay, so he stays maybe a day or two in each of the those two cities before he comes to Thessalonica. One thing to know about Thessalonica is that it was the capital city of Macedonia at the time. It's one of the more well-known port cities in the area. It is a considerable population at the time. I think I saw somewhere around 70 or 80,000 people lived in the city at this time. And it was a major point of commerce. Okay, as people were crossing over from one side of the sea to the other, the port in Thessalonica was one of the main ports that they would come to, because from it, it led through, there were roads leading through all the rest of Macedonia, to all the other major parts of ancient Greece. And Macedonia, by the way, is one of the two divisions of Greece that the Romans made, right? If we go back to this map, you see Macedonia in orange and Achaia south of there in green. Those are the two divisions of the main part of Greece that the Romans sort of put in place. So Thessalonica is kind of a big deal, okay? So back in chapter 17, verse 2, according to Paul's custom, he went to them and for three Sabbaths reasoned with them from the scriptures, explaining and giving evidence that the Christ had to suffer and rise again from the dead, and saying, this Jesus whom I am proclaiming to you is the Christ. And some of them were persuaded to join, and they joined Paul and Silas, along with a large number of the God-fearing Greeks and a number of the leading women. But the Jews, becoming jealous and taking along some wicked men from the marketplace, formed a mob and set the city in an uproar, and attacking the house of Jason, they were seeking to bring them out to the people. When they did not find them, they began dragging Jason and some of the brethren before the city authorities, shouting, these men who have upset the world have come here also. And Jason has welcomed them, and they all act contrary to the decrees of Caesar, saying that there is another king, Jesus. They stirred up the crowd and the city authorities who heard these things, and when they had received a pledge from Jason and the others, they released them. Continuing in verse 10 real quick, the brethren immediately sent Paul and Silas away by night to Berea, and when they arrived, they went into the synagogue of the Jews. Now these were more noble-minded than those in Thessalonica, for they received the word with great eagerness, examining scripture daily to see whether these things were so. One thing I want to point out, the reference there of the Bereans being more noble-minded is a specific dig on the Jews in Thessalonica, not everyone in Thessalonica. Because you'll notice, it says in verse 5, But the Jews, becoming jealous and taking along some wicked men from the marketplace, formed a mob and did all these things to drive them out. Then when he came to Berea, he says how the Bereans were searching Scripture daily. That would have been the Jews, right? Not Gentiles searching Scripture daily. It would have been the Jews that were doing that. So the more noble-minded Bereans were the Jewish members in Berea that were searching Scripture daily to see whether the things that Paul taught were true or not. So that's not a dig on all of the Thessalonians, which is important because we're going to see in a moment that he's rather happy with how they're doing. He's rather impressed. He's very thankful and grateful for how the Thessalonians are doing. And so that, combined with this reference here, that the Bereans are more noble-minded, it doesn't make a lot of sense if it's just a wholesale diss on all the Thessalonians. Okay, so that wasn't necessarily the case. So from Berea, he then went to Athens, and real quick cliff notes for the rest of chapter 17 and into verse 18. He went from Athens, he did the sermon on Mars Hill, the altar to an unknown God. Then he came to Corinth, where Silas and Timothy met up with him. Okay, so skip to chapter 18. And verse 5. So verse 1 through 4, he meets Priscilla and Aquila. They are tent makers. He stays with them a bit. But then in verse 5, when Silas and Timothy came down from Macedonia, Paul began devoting himself completely to the word, solemnly testifying to the Jews that Jesus was the Christ. So something happened between the time that Paul left Thessalonica and the time he arrived in Corinth. He actually sent Silas and Timothy away to see about the Thessalonians, at least specifically Timothy to the Thessalonians. Silas was maybe in Berea still and stayed there a little bit, but Timothy specifically was sent back to the Thessalonians to check on them, to see how they were. We will get into that specific reference in the second chapter of 1 Thessalonians. We won't get there tonight, but just so you know that when he says Silas and Timothy rejoined him, that's because he sent them off to check on folks before rejoining back with Paul. And that's a specific clue for us to a couple things. Number one, his faith in Timothy. Remember, Timothy had just joined them at the start of this journey, right? They got, I don't know how many miles that would have been, but they got maybe a fifth or a sixth of the way through their missionary journey to Lystra, where Timothy joined them, okay? Somebody, otherwise a stranger to Paul and Silas, joined them. He continues on with them. We don't hear much mention of Timothy doing specific things. In fact, even when it talks about the event where they're jailed, it only says Paul and Silas. Now, that doesn't mean Timothy wasn't jailed, but the focus, I think, from Luke telling this story is about Paul and Silas on this missionary journey. Even in Berea, Thessalonica, Luke talks about things happening to Paul and Silas, but we know Timothy was there as well because he stayed with them through that time. And another reason why it's significant is it's going to give us a very narrow window for the date for which Paul wrote this letter to the Thessalonians. Okay, so that's going to really help us to identify that date here in just a little bit. There is more about that in chapter 3 of Thessalonians, or Thessalonians, but we'll get to that at that time. All right, so go ahead and turn over to 1 Thessalonians chapter 1. And the first verse, oh, by the way, I do have another picture. That's a view looking from the north to the south at current day Thessalonica. You can see some of the remnants of the ancient city. This is, I believe, the western wall of, not the synagogue, but maybe the Colosseum or the arena or whatever they have there. And of course, you see all the more modern buildings here, the port area down by the sea, and you can even see some coastlines a little further off in the distance as you're seeing some islands across the Aegean Sea. So that's kind of a modern day view of the city that we're talking about. So back in 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, we're presented with a little bit of a mystery, the very first verse. It says, Paul and Silvanus and Timothy To the Church of the Thessalonians, in God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, grace to you and peace. And the first thing I wonder is, who in the world is Silvanus? Who is Silvanus? This is actually Silas. This is the same person. This is the same Silas who accompanied Paul to Thessalonians and on this whole second missionary journey. How do we know that? Well, turn with me to Acts chapter 18 again real quick. In Acts chapter 18, the verse we read, verse 5, when Silas and Timothy came down from Macedonia, Paul began devoting himself completely to the word. So Paul references two other people that are with him coming to Corinth. We know that these two people were with him prior in the in his trip, all the way up until the time where they were driven out of Thessalonia, right? That is Silas and Timothy. Okay? That's important here. Remember, Luke is calling this person Silas. Now turn with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 1. Remember, this is Paul writing here, and verse 19. He's writing to the Corinthians, right? For the Son of God, Christ Jesus, who was preached among you by us, by me and Silvanus and Timothy, was not yes and no, but is yes in him. So Paul references two other people, Silvanus and Timothy. Luke references Silas and Timothy. It's not the case that these gentlemen are getting confused who was there. This is just two names for the same person, right? Which is not uncommon. Paul had two names. Apostle Peter had two names. There are a lot of occurrences where people have two names in the New Testament, names that they are known by commonly, names that they are known by formally. In this case, Paul referred to this gentleman as Silvanus because, as he wrote to the Corinthians, Silvanus and Timothy were with him. As he writes to the Thessalonians, Silvanus and Timothy greet you with me. And Luke referred to this gentleman as Silas. Okay? So nothing to get overly concerned with here. Paul refers to him as Silvanus, and Luke refers to him as Silas. All right. So back in 1 Thessalonians, he says, grace to you and peace. Grace and peace, both letters to the Thessalonians contain this greeting. In fact, this is these two words, grace and peace. Mercy is another word that Paul uses. These occur a lot in the greetings that Paul gives to the various churches. Grace is the kind of the typical Greek greeting. Okay, a lot of these folks were Greeks, right? They were Gentiles. So he says, grace to you and peace, meaning shalom, the Jewish greeting for peace. Okay, so let's read now verses 2 through 5 as we kind of get into a verse-by-verse breakdown. It says, we give thanks to God always for you, for all of you, making mention of you in our prayers, constantly bearing in mind your work of faith and labor of love, of steadfastness and steadfastness of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ in the presence of our God and Father, knowing, brethren, beloved by God, his choice of you, for our gospel did not come to you in word only, but also in power and in the Holy Spirit and with full conviction, just as you know what kind of men we proved to be among you for your sake. All right, so in verse 2, Paul continues the plural greeting here. All right, he says, Paul, Silvanus, and Timothy are greeting you. And then in verse 2, he says, we give thanks. So he's kind of referring to, when he says we, he's talking about those three individuals that he first names there. This would be significant for a church that he spent so little time with, right? That he's so thankful for them, and he mentions so many great things about them, yet he was only there for 3 weeks, right? He was there for three Sabbaths before he was driven out to Berea, which he was also chased down in that city. So that's significant for Paul to mention how amazed he is and thankful he is for all of them. Verse 3, Paul says that there are three things they constantly have in mind about the Thessalonians. They are their work of faith, their labor of love, and their steadfastness of hope. Your Bibles might say patience of hope for that. So let me rephrase those three things: faith, hope, and love. Does that sound familiar at all? right? That's from 1 Corinthians 13, verse 13. Faith, hope, and love, and the greatest of these is love. That's, Paul says that very similar message to the Corinthians. They are active in all of these things, okay? It's not just that they have faith, hope, and love. It's that they're active. They're moving forward. There's action to all of these. He says they have a work of faith. That's implying an energetic, active faith, a contagious faith, not a faith that just sort of sits on its own and is its own little bubble, but it's active, it's moving, it's a work that they're performing with this faith. They have a labor of love, which implies that there are acts of kindness that they're performing to other people, which is a sign of their love. Okay, that's how their love is put into labor. The hope in particular is given a direction in this verse. It says that their hope is in Jesus, in God the Father, right? This is a steadfast hope or a patient hope. Okay, so this is a hope that persists. It is a long-suffering hope. It is a long-lasting hope. And it's not a hope just to have hope, just because you feel good about it. It's very specifically a hope in our Lord Jesus Christ, in the presence of our God and Father. All right, so Jesus is the target, is the object of their hope. Verse 4, he says, knowing, brethren, beloved by God, his choice of you. Now, this one might be a little bit tricky. Verse 4 in the King James Version says, knowing, brethren, beloved, your election of God. So we're going to key in on a couple words here. Choice, in a lot of the more modern translations, modern meaning like 19th or 20th century, and election in some of the older translations, okay? Choice and election. Now, if we're just reading this on the surface, just skimming through, it sounds like God chose each of these Thessalonians individually to save them. But is that the case? When verse 4 talks about knowing, it says, knowing, brethren, his choice of you, Paul's basically saying that he knows, or he and Silvanus and Timothy know of God's choice in you. And the way he knows that is the things he just talked about, because he's constantly bearing in mind their faith, their hope, and their love. He knows about those things. He's been told about those qualities that the Thessalonians have. So those are indicators to him of God's choice of them, or God's election of them. Okay? We need not conclude this to be a predetermined individual choice. Paul knows this by evidence of the things they just talked about. These are the fruits of a saved person. They have been sealed by the Holy Spirit, and so they are promoting these evidences, these fruits of the Spirit. So how do we know that they are sealed before, or not necessarily chosen before the foundation of the earth individually? Well, let's turn over real quick to Ephesians chapter 1, because we dealt with very similar language in the letter to the Ephesians. The letter to the Ephesians, the first chapter, contains a lot of the same language that God chose them in Christ. The word election is showing up there. It'd help if I went to the right verse, the right book. Yeah, so verse 4 of Ephesians chapter 1, he chose us in him. Everything is referencing being in Christ. And then in verse 13, it says, in him you also, after listening to the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation, having also believed, you were sealed in him with the Holy Spirit of promise. So there's a very important order of events here. After listening to the message of truth, having also believed, you were sealed. The sealing, or the election, the choice of the person, comes after they have listened and believed. Okay, so that's very important right there. We got to get that straight, or we're going to be thinking it's all in the reverse. God chose them, so he gave them the gospel and caused them to believe. That's not the order that we're seeing here. We're seeing in Jesus, after listening to the message, after believing, you were sealed in him with the Holy Spirit of promise. Okay, because after they believed, they obeyed, they were baptized, so on and so forth. So that's the order that the Ephesian letter spells this out very specifically. And so this is the order, but the same author here, Paul, in 1 Thessalonians, he says, knowing, brethren, beloved by God, his choice of you. He knows that God has chosen them because he sees their fruits of a sealed person. Okay? So he has confidence that God has chosen them, God has sealed them, because they're showing these fruits of the Spirit. Okay? So we got to make sure we have the order correct there, so we don't go off into thinking that God has only chosen specific individuals and just leaves everyone else to be damned to hell on purpose. That's not in God's character. That's not how election and sealing works. So in verse 5 of 1 Thessalonians, this election occurred in part because of the gospel brought to them. Okay, so Paul says, our gospel did not come to you in word only. So he's saying, that, you know, he's talking about how you were just chosen in God. He knows that he's confident that you were chosen in God because our gospel didn't come to you in word only, but it came to you in power, in the Holy Spirit, and with full conviction. Okay, so I think there's a little bit of dual nature in the way that this gospel was brought to them. So we can say in a lot of ways that Paul brought the gospel with all these things. So these things came along with Paul. That was the power by which it was presented. That was by the Holy Spirit. That was with Paul as he's proclaiming all these things. And that was with conviction, the manner in which Paul spoke, right? The authority by which Paul spoke had conviction with it, right? But we can also see and understand that the gospel on its own, by itself, has all these things as well. It has power, right? It is brought by the Holy Spirit. It is convicting, right? It's sharp as any two-edged sword. It pierces to the heart. It is powerful in that it can cause people to experience that conviction and turn. So the gospel itself has all these things, but also Paul would have had all these things presenting that gospel. So you could, you know, you can argue and split hairs, I think, of which thing that he's referring to this. But I think the conviction part is in particular reference to Paul himself, because what he does after he says with full conviction, he says, just as you know what kind of men we prove to be among you for your sake. So he's talking about the conviction by which the gospel was brought to them, and then he talks about what kind of men we were. Me and Silvanus and Timothy, he's talking about. And why was that? Well, because of the persecution they faced when they were there, right? The taunts and the heckling and the bringing before judges that they had to face when they were there. That's how these people know what kind of men they were proved to be among. For your sake, meaning in order to bring you the gospel, we endured all of these things, okay? We endured all kinds of tribulations to bring you the gospel. And remember, that occurred in just 3 weeks. It was just 3 weeks that they stirred up the Jews who then followed them to Berea. So they endured a lot for these Thessalonians to be able to bring them the gospel. All right, let's read verses 6 through 8. He says, you also became imitators of us and of the Lord, having received the word in much tribulation with the joy of the Holy Spirit, so that you became an example to all the believers in Macedonia and in Achaia. For the word of the Lord has sounded forth from you, not only in Macedonia and Achaia, but also in every place your faith toward God has gone forth, so that we have no need to say anything. Their imitation was through the tribulation and the persecution. That's specifically what Paul's talking about here. You became imitators of us and of the Lord, having received the word in much tribulation. Okay, the tribulation that they received was very shortly referenced in Acts chapter 17. If you remember verse 5 and 6 and 7, it talks about this man called Jason, who was dragged out to the courts or whomever, and he was made to give a pledge. So Jason is obviously one of the men or one of the people who provided a place for the Christians, specifically these three men, to be able to stay, to be able to house the church, to be able to worship in his home. So Jason is the person that they're focusing on, saying he's allowing these people to preach this message that's stirring up the world, so they drag him in front of the courts and everybody. And that's the tribulation that they were going through. And it continued after Paul and Timothy and Silas left. And because of that, they became kind of famous. The Thessalonians became a little bit famous in the area for the tribulation that they had to endure, and yet they maintained. Yet they kept their faith. They continued to preach the word. He says in verse 7, you became an example to all the believers in Macedonia and in Achaia. So these are the two provinces of Greece that we talked about. And they're an example to everyone in that area. Basically, the whole west side of the Aegean Sea, right? Macedonia and Achaia are that entire west side of the Aegean Sea. And Thessalonica is an example. Their faith and the tribulation that they had to go through is an example for everyone in that area. Okay? Through what they suffered for the gospel, they became examples. Verse 8. This verse is not referring to the Thessalonian church's missionary spread of the gospel, right? It says, for the word of the Lord has sounded forth from you. They didn't really have any like missionaries, any evangelists that went out from Thessalonica. Okay, Timothy had to be sent back to them to check on them. The reason that the word of the Lord sounded forth from them was because of the tribulation that they had to go through. It was because of their faithfulness that they became so well known. So in a sense, the word of the Lord, or the faithfulness of the Lord's people, went out from both Macedonia and Achaia. They were lacking in nothing in their faith, and they required no correction for their faith, as he says here. So that we have no need to say anything there at the end of verse 8. Also in verse 8, he says, not only in Macedonia and Achaia, but also in every place your faith toward God has gone forth. When he says in every place, this is hyperbole. It's basically a way of saying all over the place, all over the world. Everyone I talk to knows about you and your faith. That's not literally, you know, in each and every town all over the world. It's not a literal explanation of geography. It's a hyperbolic statement, just a way to relay how large a spread their faith has had and been heard throughout the whole world. Part of the widespread nature of this was Thessalonica standing as a major commercial port, right? We talked about that a little bit. One of the easiest ways to become well known is if there's a lot of people coming and going out of your town, and they hear rumor or reference of, or they meet these Christians, and the thing that's said about them over and over and over again is that they're faithful to the end. You know, these are staunch people. They don't turn from God. Through all this persecution and tribulation, they're remaining faithful. We can't get them to turn. All these kinds of things to be said about them. People coming and going, businessmen and women coming and going, and traveling throughout the entire rest of Europe and East Asia, they're going to be passing that word along. You know, hey, we encountered this group of people in Thessalonia who were calling themselves the Way, or calling themselves Christians, or whatever it might have been. And here's what we learned about them. So that's how word spreads easily for folks in a place like Thessalonica. And actually, a lot of scholars suppose that Priscilla and Aquila, when they were headed down from Rome, remember these are the two people that met Paul in Corinth in Acts chapter 18. These are the tent makers that he shared a tent maker as well, and he stayed with them. They would have come down from Rome, traveled through Thessalonica, probably sailed from there all the way to Corinth, and probably told Paul that they ran into some Christians in Thessalonica, and so would have relayed to him what they knew about them. So that's a very likely possibility there, Priscilla and Aquila relaying word about the Thessalonians. All right, verse 9 and 10, and then we'll wrap this up. It says, for they themselves report about us what kind of a reception we had with you, and how you turned to God from idols to serve a living and true God, and to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, that is Jesus, who rescues us from the wrath to come. At the beginning of verse 9, he says, they themselves, this is referring to those delivering reports about the Thessalonians' faith. Okay, they report of how well they received the word, and and how firmly it was planted into them. So people are coming to Paul and telling how they heard about Paul preaching to these people and how firm in their faith they still were. That's what it means when he says, they report about us what kind of a reception we had with you. So it's a little, it's kind of confusing language, but basically other people are telling him what they heard about how he preached to them. Okay, if that makes sense. So in other words, if we can apply a parable that Jesus used here, there's no rocky soil on these people. There's no thorns being choked out faith when they receive the word, right? These folks were fruitful ground. They were ground ready to be planted and grown when the word was presented to them. Here at the second part of chapter, verse 9, when it says, how you turned to God from idols to serve a living and true God. This is one of the phrases that Paul uses to kind of clue us into the fact that these were mostly Gentile converts. You wouldn't say of a Jew or a proselyte that they turned to God from idols, because they wouldn't have been serving idols before, right? They would have been serving God the Father, just not through Jesus. So he wouldn't say of them, they turned to God from idols. So when he says you turned to God from idols, that's a clue to us that these are mostly Gentile converts. These were pagans. These were folks who believed in a lot of the Roman myths, a lot of the Greek myths about gods and everything. So that's a good clue to us of what type of person or what type of background was made up of the believers here in Thessalonica. Verse 10, for the early church, the second coming was not taken to be something off in the distant future. They kind of thought of it as something that could come at any moment. They thought it was something they might see in their lifetime. They thought it was something that they had to be well prepared for. They thought it was something that they themselves were to be waiting on, as he says here in verse 10, to wait for his son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, that is Jesus who rescues us from the wrath to come. So they were fully expecting the second coming to happen in their lifetime, and so they were ready for it. They were constantly preparing themselves for it, and that's something that Paul compliments them on. He's basically saying, this is a good account of you. This is a good testimony of you that you wait for his coming from heaven. When he says at the end of verse 10, Jesus is who rescues us, make a note there, that is present tense. That's not past tense, it's not future tense, that's present tense. So there's a sense, and we talk a lot about this when we talk about continuing to grow in our faith, continuing to grow in our obedience and everything. There's a sense in which Jesus saved you, past tense, on the cross. He saves you, current tense, working on your heart at all times, and he will save you, future tense, in the second coming and judgment. So there's a sense in which Jesus' salvation is at all times, in all ways, okay? But what Paul is saying here is that he rescues us from the wrath to come. He's constantly doing that. He's actively doing it. It's present tense. When he says the wrath to come here, he's talking about God's righteous indignation against sin. This is something that John the Baptist also referred to in Matthew 3, verse 7. You may recall when some of the Pharisees were coming to be baptized, he says, you brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? He's talking about the judgment that God will have against sin. And wrath is often referred to as righteous indignation. And a lot of commentators and scholars will talk about how this wrath is just as easily described as applicable love, okay? Because God's love for each and every one of us is what saves us, but it's also what brings his wrath, because he cannot be around sin, he cannot stand sin, he hates it because he loves us, and he doesn't want us to be embroiled in sin, he doesn't want us to be lost in sin, so he hates it to the point of wrath, where he will inflict wrath on all sin on the judgment day. And that's because of his love, okay? So that's the end of 1 Thessalonians chapter 1. It does end there on the note of waiting for his son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, who rescues us from the wrath to come. So that's an important conclusion, because that's not too dissimilar from the call that each and every one of us still have. We're waiting on his coming from heaven, the one who was raised from the dead, so the resurrection, and the one who rescues us from the wrath to come. That's our salvation. And that's the salvation we all look forward to. That's the salvation that we all have faith, hope, and love in. That's a salvation that we need to cling to and to be able to hold on to, and put ourselves in the position that we are spoken of as the Thessalonians were, that our faith endures all, that it goes through all kinds of tribulation, that our faith is one that can be heard around the world, and that is kind of world famous in that sense, because we should be able to maintain our faith through all tribulation, just like the Thessalonians did. So next time I am up in the evening, we'll start with chapter 2. Until then, the invitation is for any who need it. If you have need to call on Jesus as your Savior and be baptized, or if you have need to repent and make known anything to the congregation, now is the time to do that as we stand and sing.
6:39.